start, and Tony is getting ready. Allow me to use this moment to extend my gratitude, also on behalf of the Amsterdam Center for International Law, to the Hong Kong University Faculty of Law and to Tony in particular for hosting and co-hosting this this workshop. It's wonderful to be here at Hong Kong University and this start this morning promises us two very, very good days. Now, I will not abuse my position as interim chair, I would say, and really give Tony the floor once you are ready.
Yeah, once the Raymond's ready. Well, so I don't need to speak into that because of this here.
But okay, Tony, please.
I don't have PowerPoints, but I have the text of my not very long talk. And I propose to read the talk out. And for those who maybe find it difficult to follow, I'll try to slide the text up at the same time. Cardinal Richelieu between Vatel and Machiavelli. Now, a central feature of our East Asia European dialogue is that Richard Tuck believes that the scholastic humanist ethic was marginalized by a tougher humanism modeled on a resurrected vision of Roman civilization. Now, my last presentation on our FERC workshop in Amsterdam in 2012 argued that Tuck's histories of ideas did not take into account the actual practice of a country such as France, directed by the Roman Catholic Cardinal Richelieu. The 1635 French declaration of war against the Spanish Habsburgs was justified in terms of the scholastic doctrine of just war, following on advice from specialist theologians of the canon law. Randall Lesaffer from Tilburg has demonstrated all of this in his articles in the Journal of the History of International Law. Now, on this occasion, it is proposed to offer a more extensive account of Richelieu's views, looking not just back to Tuck's critique, but also forward to the second major problematic of our dialogue, the Western belief that there is or should be a universal rule of law. And this relates, I think, somewhat to Peng's questions to Susan before the break. This very abstract, slippery concept may contain within it the idea that all states are encompassed by the rule of law, but it may also imply the challenge that there are states whose ethos works against it. An account of Richelieu's thought may allow many possible reconfigurations of East Asian and European humanist comparisons. For instance, there is the argument of Marty Koskenniemi and Emmanuel Jouannet that, in fact, international law does not begin its recognizably modern form until the 18th century with the secularization of Europe through the Enlightenment, and then a clear distinction drawn between law and morality, particularly in Vatel. International law is then a liberal construct coming only after the 18th century, which applies to international relations, the logic of domestic relations among individuals. And this view is also expanded by myself 30 years ago in The Decay of International Law. States are treated as individuals and their relations with one another have to their relations with one another have to be marked by a mutual respect of freedom and equality, a very secular view of law based on consent between equals. This equality has implicit in it that the international community is plural and that relations are marked by a secular, rational logic of equality, itself consensual. And this thinking is also a response to the apparent actual plurality of international relations from a European perspective. It is this apparently innocuous liberal humanist perspective which then confronts and violently crushes the Qing, Confucian, Chinese international order in the French and British attacks on Peking in 1860 and the burning of the old Summer Palace and the imposition of the liberal order on China in the treaties of Tientsin and Peking, which incorporate the legal concepts of equality and freedom of states and the compulsion of China to sign the treaty that incorporates it into this system. There is much that postmodernism has written on the manner in which the so-called Enlightenment excludes the barbarous other in its definition of the rationality and civility for which Vatel, Emir Vatel, the mid-18th century French founder of international law, he's French-Swiss. Peter Fitzpatrick has set this out in his study, The Desperate Vacuum, Imperialism and the Law in the Experience of Enlightenment, in a book I edited 30 years ago, Postmodern Law. Fitzpatrick's arguments are that perhaps a variant of Tuck's, that Enlightenment liberal rationalism cannot project the universal, but has to define itself against the other. The universalist project contains an anti-universalist contradiction. The affirmation of the universal has to include the exclusion of what is not recognized as worthy to be part of the universal. Tuck, perhaps in contrast, recognizes that a new humanist vision of Rome-inspired greatness was more crudely conflictual and did not have to conceal its brutality beneath an ideology. Now, the great interest of Richelieu and his companions, King Louis, misprint there, King Louis XIII of France and the Eminence Grise, Père Joseph, a Capuchin monk who was the right-hand man of Richelieu, is that they in turn provide alternative paradigms in European thought, very much as much another for the European Enlightenment, looking back from to the 17th century from the 18th century, as East Asia will be for the European Enlightenment looking east in the 19th century. Indeed, Richelieu is castigated by Emmanuel Juanet as an admirer of Machiavelli, and thereby given his undoubted prominence in his time, let's say Richelieu's, a proof that no form of international law could have existed in Europe in the 17th century. That is the barbaric age of religious bigotry and religious feuding and war. In her liberal welfarist Law of Nations, she attributes to Richelieu admiration for Machiavelli's precept that there is no dishonor in breaking conventions by which the nation has been committed to a course of action. She argues that as no one could write this in the 18th century, what Richelieu is supposed to have thought in the 17th century, where pacta sunt servanda, the idea the treaty should be observed, had become a legal rule binding on states. Now, these are all assertions of Joannet, for which she provides no references at all. This is astonishingly 21st century ideology. In other words, Richelieu is as alien to modern Western international law imagination as the Ming and the Qing dynasties, which were his contemporaries, and which he appears to the author to resemble in a number of respects, especially his absolutist authoritarianism linked to a version of heavenly legitimacy. Richelieu pursues a doctrine which brings together religious faith and reason in a divine right of kings, a royal absolutism. This attributed to Louis, this time spelt correctly, 13th, an authority which did not merely come from God, but was actually about the implementation of God's will on earth. There was not to be incompatible with reason, but reason was concerned with the practical implementation of divine will. This is a way of thinking about international society, which it is very difficult for Europeans to understand now. But if one goes back to Machiavelli's rejection of the Christian medieval tradition at the time of the Italian Renaissance, at the end of the 15th century, one may see that the humanism of which Tuck treats as becoming predominant Western European culture had an ontological as well as an ethical aspect. The question was not simply how individuals or princes treated one another, but also how they were compelled to treat one another by the nature of reality. There was a part of reality which man could not know, not predict or control. And Hernan will talk about that this afternoon, the Tao and the unnameable. And I think there's rather a lot of the unnameable about arguments about natural law and divine law and so on. There was a part of reality which man could not know, predict, or control. It was described as blind fate or fortuna in the Roman civilization. It recognized existence as constantly threatening, requiring drastic measures, not merely a preemption against the other, but a constant need to reconfigure the contour of relations in constantly changing circumstances. So there is actually a link here with modern realism in international relations theory. Now, for the religious spirit of Richelieu, this reality was also present, but he gave it a different name, the struggle between God and Satan. As an avid reader of the Spanish mystics such as Teresa of Avila, Richelieu considered that the phenomenal world, recognizable in Machiavelli's work, called instead for an acknowledgement of God's mysterious command of the universe. Man's unequal partnership with God signified that the king, as God's agent, had a responsibility to discern the opaque complexity of existence in a spirit of humble quest after divine inspiration, in a spirit of prayer. In other words, there was a clearly marked out in French thinking a doctrine of tientia, literally of a lord under heaven. Although, as will be seen in more detail later, Machiavelli also had a doctrine of heaven. It did not mean a sole imperial authority, and instead was dedicated, in Richelieu's world, to opposing that vision in the form of a universal Habsburg state spanning the whole of Europe. Indeed, plurality was the true context of the French policy. It is possible that the vision of Richelieu and Père Joseph was very close to that of Mencius in the Chinese Warring States spring and autumn period. France, as a very large state, also well situated geographically, as well as in possession of a very special Christian spirituality, no spiritual modesty here, had the leading responsibility to lead other European princes, states, and nations to a priest of Christendom, primarily through protecting the weak against the strong and otherwise mediating differences. The French religious vision, Richelieu's religious vision, was one of harmony of all under heaven, that is, under God's will, where the small would be secure against the large, each having its place. Even the idea of law itself, in the narrower sense of dynastic titles, claims of the French crown to patrimonial lands, had to be moderated and presented only in the context of the possibility of the overall harmony of Europe. These ideas of law and hegemonial direction are set out fully by Fritz Dieckmann in his Rechtsgedanke und Machtpolitik bei Richelieu, Studien an neuen gedeckten Quellen, in his Friedensrecht und Friedenssicherung, and also by Lucien Belli, La construction hésitante et fragile d'une puissance moderne in Histoire de la diplomatie française. Europe itself was always a competing picture of unity in a Roman Christendom alongside a diversity of independent Christian European rulers. France's majesty hovered delicately around this contradiction, favoring Richelieu's exploration of benign hegemony within the concept of a unitary cultural world. This was also much closer to the Chinese world of Mencius, with a special role for large states in relation to smaller ones, more special than the lucidly atomistic autonomy of equal states of Vattel's vision. Richelieu's vision was equally distinct from the Habsburg vision, which Richelieu abhorred. That is a concrete, unitary, universal state. As Dieckmann has shown, the archival proof of Richelieu's perspectives rests in his instructions to his ambassadors in preparation for the 1648 Westphalia peace negotiations, which he prepared shortly before his own death in December 1642. So this material has been set out both by Lucien Belli and by Fritz Dieckmann. I am more interested in the ideas underlying Richelieu's vision. If one returns to the question whether one can speak only of a rule of international law or a law of nations after Vattel and into the 19th century, this will help one to focus one's inquiry concerning Richelieu more sharply on the closeness of the relationship in his mind between the rule of God, the rule of reason, and the rule of law. That is to say, the focus of our study will be firstly more on the role of methods in the shaping of normative order in Richelieu's thinking, before coming to consider secondarily and more briefly the specific content of Richelieu's European order, particularly with respect to treaties and the questions of war. Now, Richelieu begins his political testament with the words, "The reign of God is the principle of government of states, and indeed it is a thing so absolutely necessary that without that foundation it is impossible for any prince to rule well or for any state to be happy. But all men are so sensible by their own reason that their origin does not proceed from themselves, but that a God is their creator and consequently their director, that they all feel that nature has imprinted that truth in their hearts with indefatigable character. And so many princes have been laden with blessings in submitting their authority to that from which it was derived, for having only sought their grandeur in that of their creator and having taken more care of his reign than of their own." Now, in his seminal magisterial work by Richard Chirk, Richelieu and Reason of State, he comments that in this passage, Richelieu seems to be groping for words to express how central were the religious qualities and purposes of royal government. Hence, the personal example of the sovereign himself, the good life of the prince, is the living law, and more effectively compelling than all the laws that they might take to coerce towards the good that they wish to procure. The converse of the reign of God is clear, where Richelieu continues, "So many princes have undone themselves and their states by laying the foundation of their conduct upon a judgment contrary to their knowledge of God, and so many have been filled with benedictions for having subjecting their authority to that from which it was derived." So Church notes that here Richelieu is speaking of government according to a higher law. Nothing could be clearer than that Richelieu considered this dimension to be essential for the rulers of Christian states. The same applies to ministers as to princes. The law of God requires precepts beyond the standards of honesty among men. The ideal minister should be versed in both, but if there's any question of deficiency, it should be in earthly wisdom, because knowledge of God's law is fundamental, and without it, the minister cannot be expected to understand more ordinary matters. In a word, the statesman must be faithful to God, to the state, to men, and himself in that order. Nonetheless, the chief resource for Richelieu in fulfilling these obligations was reason. In his words, "Natural knowledge convinces us that man, being created reasonable, reason ought to be the ground of his actions, since otherwise he would act against his nature, and consequently against him who is the author of it. There is an exact correspondence of absolute reason, rule, and obedience. Richelieu clearly excludes all that it is arbitrary or unreasonable. And I quote again, that is, we ought never to will anything but that which is just and reasonable, so we must never will anything without putting it into execution and without exacting an entire obedience to our commands, since otherwise reason would not reign sovereignly. The practice of that rule is easier in that love is the most powerful motive to oblige men to obey, and that it is impossible for subjects not to love the prince when they are sensible that reason is the guide of all their actions." Now, Church summarizes Richelieu's reasoning as signifying effective government is procured through following the precepts of divine law through maximum application of human reason. The successful pursuit of state goals is simultaneously reasonable and for the purpose of achieving religiously defined objectives. Church goes on to consider how Richelieu understood the notion, usually attributed to Machiavelli, of reason of state. For Richelieu, it signified the rule of reason in political affairs, that kings and ministers, being men of superior intellect and power, as well as being divinely bestowed with reason, should invariably act in accordance with reason. At the same time, there is also the issue of a means-ends rationality, also predicated on the legitimacy of a higher morality of state policy at the expense of traditional legal and moral values. In matters of domestic security, Richelieu, notes Church, had a doctrine of emergency in recognition of the fact that conspiracies against the public welfare are usually conducted with such cleverness and secrecy that one has no clear proof of them until they happen, which is when it's too late. However, it was an essential part of his religious faith that Richelieu did not give such a large space for conjecture in public affairs so as to undermine any possibility of public order, national or international. Instead, as Church quotes him, Richelieu considered how good conscience and penetrating judgment of a judicious mind, being learned in the course of affairs, discerns the future through the presence and shields this practice from a bad outcome. This very intensely personal and private foundation for normative order can only make any external review of the conduct of states under absolutism very problematic. The element of accountability attaching to the rule of law appears impossible to realize. As Church explains, divine absolutism means that Richelieu had been chosen by God to guide France through the royal majesty, which is the second majesty after the divine, that's to say Louis XIII, who found in his mind, Richelieu's, the means to solving all his problems. Drawing here from Richelieu's memoirs, Church remarks how the cardinal is supposed to enable his majesty, his master, to emerge gloriously from the challenges of the unpredictable world because of God's grace. It is not simply the intimacy of this relationship which is impenetrable. It is also the ontological foundation of the wider reality the relationship is confronting. Now, this brings one back to the fear of uncertainty, also in the face of international conspiracies, which have hardly gone away at present. It is stated in the memoirs that it is the prayer of the king which is rewarded by the divine benevolence, where the end and purpose of the war declared against Spain in 1635, but now we are in 1638, is the peace of Christendom. God has rewarded the king with the birth of a boy, the future Louis XIV. And this birth is taken as a sign of divine aid in the many good fortunes, but also great uncertainties of France. In any case, Richelieu, Church draws upon a huge group of publicists working on Richelieu's behalf to explain his thinking. Among others, there's a guy called Duplay, whose work indicates how obscure the decision-making process would have been in Richelieu's France. Decisions between the prince and the director, that is to say Richelieu, as matters of state, are such as not to discuss with other ministers, and the secret may not be divulged. Church quotes Duplay. After all, since political government is organized after the model of the celestial hierarchy, no criticism of it can be made. For as God established an intelligence in each celestial sphere to activate it and cause it to revolve according to its natural course, so that which guides the movement of the primary body gives an impulse to all the others and forces them to rotate every 24 hours. So that each of our inferior ministers should carry out his particular function and daily account to the first minister Richelieu with a full and punctual report. This religious faith is the frame encompassing the dangerous and unpredictable world of politics, national and international. But this world was in the safe hands chosen by Louis XIII, his minister Richelieu. Louis's greatest achievement was to choose a minister who combined loyalty to Christian principles with knowledge of the secrets of state. Church quotes another of Richelieu's intellectual messengers and interpreters, Durin, that kings have certain obscure designs which resemble prophecies and can be best understood only after their fulfillment. Church comments on this typical structure of absolutist thought. Unquestioning reverence by the subjects for the superior knowledge of kings and ministers of the secrets of all state, all within an ontological frame of reference. However, this ontological foundation, which Richelieu sought for international order, a metaphysical response to the radical contingency of reality, was to serve this order, not to undermine it. The doctrines and policies of Richelieu could be and were restrained and moderate in style and execution because of his religious faith in the benevolence of an international order in the safekeeping of God's anointed officers. For instance, Richelieu sees the obligation of treaties as resting in the honor and reputation to the good faith of the prince. He sees the greater prince as more vulnerable than the smaller prince because being already so materially advantaged, his reputation will mean more than for a weaker state, a prince. For the latter, his advantage will matter more than his honor. For example, infidelity to an ally will matter much less to the weaker prince if he thinks he can thereby make a disparity in power with his neighbors. In Richelieu's exact words, a king must take great care what treaties they make. Kings must take great care, but when they are made, they must keep them religiously. I am sensible that many publicists teach the contrary, but without considering in their place what the Christian faith affords us against these maxims, I maintain that since the loss of honor is greater than the loss of life, a great prince should venture his life and even the interests of his state rather than break his word, which he can never violate without losing his reputation and consequently the greatest force of his strength. As Church also explains, Richelieu thought reputation so important, a good opinion for whose loss they should risk to sacrifice fate and grandeur, that he went so far as to insist rulers should reject all gains that conflicted with their honor. Church remarks further that treaty relations for Richelieu were a matter of relations with fellow princes, where the interests of the state were of less moment than principles of princely honor. So Richelieu even carried this doctrine into the area of war for national good. War is sometimes inevitable and necessary for such purposes as to regain lost territory, avenge an insult, protect one's allies, stem the progress of a conqueror, and forestall ills that threaten and cannot otherwise be met. But before undertaking any such war, those in charge of state policy must determine its justice according to the most fundamental principles of Christian morality. In the Political Testament, Richelieu writes himself that there can be no successful war unless it is just, because if it is not, even though the occasion for it may be favorable according to worldly precepts, it will be necessary to render an account for it before the tribunal of God. Therefore, a thorough examination of the equity of war has to be made by theologians of requisite capacity. The anti-Spanish policy against a fellow Catholic state was believed to be justified by Christian morality. Church notes how Richelieu concludes his political testament by emphasizing the obligations of kings and ministers to rule justly in the sight of God. So Richelieu affirms, if they, kings and ministers, use their power to commit some injustice or injury that they cannot do as private persons, they commit a sin as a prince or magistrate that has its origin solely in their authorship and for which the King of Kings will demand the most exacting account at Judgment Day. Now, Machiavelli and Richelieu, harsh humanism versus harsh Catholicism. As noted in the introduction, Juvenet has identified Richelieu as an admirer of Machiavelli. Now, in his magisterial Thoughts on Machiavelli, Leo Strauss explains the thought of Machiavelli that began with the principle that the imitation of the beast should take the place of the imitation of God. Machiavelli replaces the imitation of God man with the beast man Charon. Apparently foreshadowing Nietzsche in Strauss's interpretation, Machiavelli says in the discourses that the goodness and morality of the people are essentially preserving and conservative, not innovative and revolutionary. In contrast, the prototype of princes is Romulus, the fratricide. Strauss says that we suspect that Machiavelli sometimes uses the word princes not to designate monarchs or even human government in general, but superhuman powers. In contrast, Christianity, in Machiavelli's view, has lowered esteem for the honor of the world. The example of Rome points instead to the demand for the strength of the world, whereas Christianity has led the world into weakness. There is harmony between the truth and worldly strength, but Christianity loses this by preaching abjectness and humility. The highest Christian good is God, who has assumed humility and weakness. So according to Machiavelli, man will not reach his highest stature if he himself does not demand the highest from himself without reliance or support from outside himself. Consciousness of excellence must take the place of consciousness of guilt and sin. Now, in terms of law, Machiavelli's system expresses the ontological fact of man's aloneness. Beyond himself, all is change and uncertainty. Given the instability of human things, states cannot choose the true way or the right means, which consists in keeping what one has and in not taking from others what belongs to them. One is forced to choose one of the extremes, either to allow the others to take away from one what one has, or else to take away from others what belongs to them. In other words, the rule of law, universal rule of law, is ontologically impossible. Honor, worldly honor, dictates the choice of the latter. This perspective rests upon what Strauss called Machiavelli's assertoric quasi-theology. Drawing upon the Roman historian Livy's concept of fortune rather than God, fortune and heaven are used synonymously. The end which fortune pursues is unknown, and so are her ways according to that end. However, the fact that well-being depends upon vanquishing fortune means that it is the enemy. Since the success of or failure of individuals depends ultimately on unconquerable chance. The rule, conquer fortune, is insufficient. Excellent men will rise above chance. Dignity consists not in conquering chance, but in independence. Machiavelli's perspective is therefore the instability of things. Yet since all human things are in flux, one cannot do what reason suggests, but must sometimes do what necessity demands. A consistent policy limited to preservation is impossible. One must choose between losing to others what one possesses or take from others what they possess. But the latter course is more honorable than the former. One cannot leave it then to sacrificing the virtue of giving. One must choose, at sacrificing the virtue of giving, one must choose the rapacity, choose the vice of rapacity. At the same time, Machiavelli addresses the world of classical political philosophy, especially in the writings of Aristotle. These imagined republics are based upon the premise that most men are good, but if most are bad, the ruler cannot possibly rule his subjects if he does not adapt himself in considerable measure to their badness. Aristotle also believes most men are bad, desiring wealth and honor, but this leads him to conclude that the best men, to be rewarded with outstanding honors, ought to rule the many bad men by coercing them, while remaining immune to badness themselves. However, Machiavelli thought this stance was vague and ambiguous on one essential point. Morality is only possible after the conditions for it have been created, and these conditions cannot be created morally. In contrast, Aristotle sometimes thought that moral badness of men can be overcome through habituation to laws in political society, a process of customization in society. Whereas Machiavelli argued that if virtue presupposes political society itself is preceded by pre-moral or sub-moral men, and indeed founded by such men. There cannot be a moral law of unconditional validity. Hence, morality is possible only when created outside morality. And that this is an ontological argument, that political society is created out of a void by the power of an almighty but amoral being, the excellent man. Machiavelli thinks this ontological argument is easily demonstrated logically. If one supposes men good, in this case, they do not need political society. Alternatively, one can suppose that political society is created by men of heroic virtue. That is a moral virtue which is not, despite Aristotle saying this is impossible, derived from habituation to political society. Now, Machiavelli believes that in the classical tradition there is an unwarranted belief in human goodness. But instead it is not divine or divinely inspired benefactors of the human race, but men like Cesare Borgia, and especially the criminal emperor Severus of Rome, who are revealed to be the true founders of society. Foundation takes place wherever society as a whole is in grave danger from within or without. In all such situations, the modes used by the original founder must be used again if there is to be society and its offspring morality. Morality can only exist on an island created and protected by immorality. Indeed, Machiavelli means precisely the necessity for tyranny, the exercise of power divorced from the common good, which creates the necessity which makes men operate well, that is to acquire by prudence and strength of what of will that for which they long. The selfish desire for personal glory, concerned with perpetual or immortal glory, drives men to the greatest possible service to others, and force and honor and glory come together because power is rooted in force as well as in courage. It is over, to conclude, that was really the beginning of another paper, it is overlooked that with Richelieu, overlooked in the histories of international law of my colleagues, Jouannet and Koskinemi and others, that with Richelieu, the linear view of the secularization of European thought through humanism is severely interrupted. While Richelieu's view of the human condition is similar to Machiavelli's, he believed with an intensity equal to his adversary that the chaos not only of human wickedness but of existence itself could be overcome with divine guidance, that through looking through the glass darkly, it was possible to discern a benign providence of God, if only by glimpses and never constantly. Now, the huge importance of Richelieu is that the modern peace of Westphalia, which he did so much to found, rested in humanistic terms on a vision which did not deny Machiavelli, but overcame him through a religious faith. This means in the absence of Richelieu is not simply theological, but also mystical vision, one is left with the shallowness of Vattel's Enlightenment self-interest, with the bonds of political society obviously absent. Joannet, in her praise of Vattel, does not mention Frederick the Great's attack upon Maria Therese's Silesia, nor Louis XIV's laying waste of the Palatinate. Vattel's silliness is merely to invite us not to question the conscience of these two great princes. He insists on the absolute freedom of sovereign princes who cannot be criticized. That is the modern doctrine of the sovereignty of states, not amenable to any compulsory authority above themselves, diabolical, but without any creative energy.
Thank you.
Well, we haven't really organized chairs here because the next speaker is the chairperson of the panel. Jan will now speak on Leibniz, and Leibniz's encounter with China and the rule of law in his universal jurisprudence. There is a more sophisticated title which I should have included here.
Okay, let me see. Okay, excellent. Okay, thanks so much, Tony. The title I changed indeed since our last workshop in December 2012. It was some time ago. I see familiar faces nodding. It was quite an exciting workshop where we laid out the groundwork for this project. A lot has happened since. Much work has been done. I'm really impressed with all the papers that will be presented here today. I'd like to Let me see. We have till 1:15, right?
No,
so I have 20.
We can
yeah. Okay. Otherwise, I will.
So
today, I'd like to talk a bit about how, in my thinking, this project came about and how it relates to Leibniz. I will then talk briefly about his theory of jus gentium and more broadly his universal jurisprudence. And in my understanding, it really is an attempt to bring all power under some sort of rule of law. The question then is, what is his conception of law? And Leibniz's conception, let me state that from the beginning, is a conception of law that includes justice. So he's one of those who does not separate law and morality, as we talked already about that this morning. And I'd like to show you his interest in the ideas he thought to be part of the Chinese tradition or the Chinese traditions. We'll talk about that a bit more. Now, as Tony already explained, the origins of this project are a bit multiple, in the sense that it is indeed related to reading Richard Tuck and seeing how Richard Tuck sweeps off the table, one could say, a tradition which I would like to call Northern humanism, he treats, for example, Erasmus and Erasmus' ideas on war in a way that you think, that doesn't really do justice to how Erasmus was looking at the world. So I think the argument, though important to the field of history and theory of international law, and it has caused a lot of interesting scholarship, it doesn't really do justice to all the different ideas out there. And we've seen alternative readings of Grotius, alternative readings presented by Susan, in which other humanists, let me call it like that, are present and have argued and conceptualized or redefined ideas that I think are relevant to take on board in order to understand our traditions. at the same time, this alternative reading was enforced, was strengthened by my own study of Leibniz. Well, I have to say more than 10, 15 years ago, when I started to be interested in Leibniz for my book on international legal personality. And I'll come back to that, but he was the one, the first one to use that term, persona jus gentium. He was the first one to use it, and my question was, why Leibniz? Why not Pufendorf? What was going on? And he was the last defender of the Holy Roman Empire. And it is related to that argument. So when I read Leibniz at the time, my arguments were focused on his conception of international legal personality, his conception of sovereignty as relative sovereignty, in contrast to Hobbes' more absolute sovereignty and Pufendorf's thinking along those lines. And I thought, there is some sort of rule of law idea working here. Obviously, he was trained as a lawyer, and that is what he brings to his scholarship. So that also was in my back of my mind when I read Richard Tuck and thought, we need to do something. We and that's ambitiously called rewriting history, but you understand what I mean. I mean, we have to make sure that the richness of this body of ideas is represented and studied also to inform our tradition of the law of nations and prevent it from being defined by definition as a law of imperialism. Well, at the same time, there is a lot of elements in that tradition of mutual respect and of speaking truth to power, and why not also bring that to the table? Now, this is the one. That's what I've just said. So let's go to this wigged guy here. I'd like the portrait in a way. You see the irony a bit in his mouth, the way he smiles. I don't know whether it's actually an accurate portrait, and he had this humor. That's hard to tell. In any case, sharp mind. Now, as you see, he was born 2 years before the Peace of Westphalia. He was born to a professor of philosophy, did a lot of studies even before going to high school in the library of his father, had a sort of independent development, and at the same time was formed through the educational structures. He lived after the Peace of Westphalia, and at the same time he was confronted with what that meant. I mean, we all have, and in any case, in our schools, when we talk about international law, what the Westphalian order is an important notion, and that's where it all started, because then international law became interstatal. And at the same time, one has to realize, I mean, he was living it. He was an advisor to all these princes that were emerging and that were claiming sovereignty and that wanted an army and wanted to be there and influence international relations, wanted to be as important as their peers. It was a time that the Holy Roman Empire was in decline, was fragmented, and the universal normative order was severely undermined. Another aspect of that, at that crisis, I would like to call it, and as Tony also put it in the title of this panel, this crisis of this universal rule of law is, of course, that the Reformation brought religious diversity, and the princes had fought these 30 years' war because of the religious diversity. And so there was a peace, but there was a lot of trouble still there, and a lot of conflicts and strife. So he understood that some sort of normative order was necessary to prevent law power from becoming arbitrary power. You see the notion of arbitrary power indeed in a lot of his writing. So that was an immediate concern. For us, Westphalian order might be something out there, but he was living it and thinking, my goodness, where is this going? And in my understanding, on the one hand, he wanted to keep the imperial structures together, but he also redefined the universal structures and importantly wanted to bring all of these powers, not just one emperor as the sovereign, but all of those claiming some sort of relative sovereignty under the rule of law, and that is why he needed something like international legal personality. And it's given, he argues, that any prince, count, whatever, all these guys that Susan was referring to, with a bit of an army and with a bit of a capacity to influence what we today call international relations between sovereigns and rulers, and a bit of a treaty-making capacity, that those were the actors that had international legal personality. Now you see the mirror of that idea is that you construct some sort of universal rule of law and keep that order. So what he does is publish what is called the Codex Juris Gentium Diplomaticus in 1693. And in the which is a collection of positive law of nations, you could say, a lot of treaties and agreements and relevant to the empire and the relations with France. And but he precedes that with a preface in which he develops his theory of jus gentium, and he explains that he deliberately does not entitle his work as a codex of juris inter gentes, inter in between peoples and between rulers, which is more of the term referring to positive law of nations. He deliberately explains that the real jus gentium, the real law of nations, is a law that incorporates natural law and natural justice. And he disputes the idea that Hobbes has put forward, that there can only be law that comes from a sovereign, and that there can only be law after a sovereign has been and the Leviathan has been established. Now, in this work, he develops a particular understanding of justice as charity of the wise. I'll get back to that. But in a nutshell, it says that one cannot be just without benevolent, that one cannot be just without aiding others. And so it is different from the Roman law idea that do no harm. No, it goes further. And he develops that idea here. Now, what of course interested me when I, what of course interested me once Tony and I started to talk and come together with our different ideas and started to think, okay, we need to do something together, this is so useful, is to expand the research done quite some time ago and relate it to Leibniz's interest in China and see whether his understanding of a universal moral legal order based on and developed from this notion of justice as wise charity, whether that did indeed expand to or included China and Chinese culture, and how would he respond to that? And one of his students or successors, Christian Wolff, later on in the 18th century, really had to flee Halle, the University of Halle, because in his last speech he was allegedly too sympathetic to China and Confucian thought. So what was Leibniz, how was Leibniz responding and dealing with China and Chinese notions? And how was that part of his days? So that was underlying my my work going into his Chinese texts. Now, he was considered by himself, I'm not sure that he was a modest man, but also by others at the time, a real expert and someone who was really extremely interested in China throughout his life. Throughout his life, not just at some point, a little remark, no, throughout his life, for decades, he was interested in China. And I think he could be so interested, he could cherish diversity, cultural diversity, and well, let me not get ahead of myself, because of his metaphysics. So I put here a quote that says, "All individual substances are different expressions of the same universe and different expressions of the same universal cause, namely God." We can talk about what God means here. He was very, we'll come to that. Now, let me tell you that for him, different cultures, including Chinese culture, was just an utter expression of ultimately the universal, the same universe, and going back to the same universal cause. So rather than to fear multiculturalism, he kind of celebrates it, and he thinks it's all about learning from each other, and that's possible because of an underlying language, an underlying conceptual world that's natural religion, and that's reason and thinking on the basis of natural reason. He takes that actually to a large extent from Grotius. So Grotius is keen on developing the natural theology and the natural religion underlying, I would say, the revealed tradition, the revealed theology and religion of Christian law. But I'm sure we'll either with the drinks or at another time talk about that. For Leibniz, it's important to say, well, it's all coming from the same origin. It's all different expressions, and we have to learn from each other. So no stress, no fear, eagerness. And that's what you see also in the next quote. He is living, as I said, in Europe, which had its challenges. Let me tell you that. We'll not go into historical details, but it was had its challenges. And yet he is outspoken about what the greatest affair of our time is. So he writes to one of the Jesuit missionaries here in China. He writes, I quote, "I judge that this mission is the greatest affair of our time, as much for the glory of God and the propagation of the Christian religion, as for the general good of man and growth of the arts and sciences among us as well as among the Chinese. For this is a commerce of light which could give us at once their work of thousands of years and render ours to them, and double so to speak our true wealth for one and the other. This is something greater than one imagines." And you really see here, of course, the start of the Enlightenment. Everyone is looking for enlightenment, for better understanding, for growing towards perfection. But this is something that has to be done in through cultural interaction. And he corresponds for decades with the Jesuit missionaries in China, and brings together texts that he finds important in this book, The News from China, and comments on all these papers and texts in another privatio, in another preface, in which he again reflects on universal justice, but also really is giving a background, you could say, to what he here calls the commerce of light. That, all different expressions, cultures, all different expressions of humanity, or through which humanity as a whole expresses itself, and on some issues, Europeans are more enlightened, more advanced, have done more research. That could be in astrology, that could be on mathematics and those kind of sciences. And a lot of he admires the Emperor Kangxi, excuse my pronunciation, for bringing all these bodies of knowledge to China. And at the same time, he says, well, there are a lot of missionaries going to China, but please let some Chinese missions come to Europe, because Chinese really seem to be superior to the Europeans in, and I quote, practical philosophy, that is the precepts of ethics and politics adapted to the present life and use of mortals, end of quote. So he somewhere says that the people are equal, and they should exchange to learn from each other. And in his view, and that's of course disputable, but in his view, Confucian tradition, Neo-Confucian tradition, is commensurable, is understandable through the lens of natural reason. So that is where he finds some sort of language and a possibility to exchange and to relate the various traditions. And he's very, very much oriented or engaging with with the principle of Li, which he translates as natural reason. Well, he translates it in multiple ways, but surely this natural reason idea is there. So as I said, this underlying body is some sort of natural religions and view on life. And that is in itself also quite controversial in Europe, because it relativizes revealed theology. And Grotius has had to flee his country, partly because he argued in a way that even revealed theology had to be in conformity with natural theology, that reason and natural reason ultimately is, it's not higher, he would never have phrased it like that, but he would interpret revealed theology, Christian theology, in conformity with natural theology and natural religion. And that was something Leibniz took on board. Now, in both this Codex Juris Gentium and the Novissima Sinica, Leibniz develops and outlines, you could say, his universal jurisprudence, and he lays down, I quote, that a good man is one who loves everybody so far as reason permits. Justice then, which is the virtue which regulates that affection, will be most conveniently defined as the charity of the wise man, that is, charity which follows the dictates of wisdom. Charity is a universal benevolence, and benevolence the habit of loving or willing the good. Love then signifies rejoicing in the happiness of another, the happiness of those whose happiness pleases us in turn, as turns into our own happiness, since things which please us are desired for their own sakes, end of quote. And you see here how he responds to Hobbes and the Hobbesian idea that everything is coming from self-interest and law cannot be more than supra-level state cannot be more than self-interest, and how human nature is completely defined by self-interest. And Leibniz responds to that and says, well, no, the interest of others become our own interest. And that's how he resolves that problem. Now, in those works, in both the Codex Juris Gentium and the Novissima Sinica, we have this universal jurisprudence, a universal legal order, in which he defines the obligations or the responsibilities of the ruler. And the ruler has to rule wisely on the basis of wise charity, of love for and benevolence for his subjects, and with restraint when it comes to the use of force. Now, that is the ideal that he seems to have found in the Emperor Kangxi, and that's extremely interesting in the Privatio to the Novissima Sinica, where he indicates a number of times in those terms that characterizes the rule by Emperor Kangxi, this wise charity, this benevolence, this love of the people, this looking for knowledge, his open-mindedness, and also open-mindedness towards Western knowledge. Now, Leibniz learned about the Chinese traditions and Chinese ideas through the Jesuit sources. As I said, he collected a lot of writings from the Jesuits, also collected translations from excerpts. He included a treaty of China and Russia in the Novissima Sinica. But what he did is indicate that there should be a return to the old classical texts. I'll come back to that. Now, another element of his interest in Chinese thought is that he was... The credibility for Leibniz, to put it like that, of Chinese thought and wisdom was their book of I Ching. And why is that? The I Ching and the yin yang and the way the graphical hexagrams resonated to Leibniz because of his mathematical language. So he thought that he that there was something in common there, and that helped him and made him extremely curious. And so he studied the book, or tried to study it rather. It was difficult. But to him, it was, he projected, or he understood, and it as written by common spirits and containing higher morality and wisdom. Now, he portrayed Kangxi as another sage king, and so that is related to the ancient texts, and he related that idea to the philosopher, the Plato philosopher king that he has been working with. He praises at various instances, also in other writings on China, he praises Kangxi for being such an excellent judge, being of unparalleled merit, because he is fearing somewhere even, or even taking into account the possibility of the judgment of history, that he is ruling by the mandate or the will of heaven, and that he is indeed, as I was saying, applying justice as caritas sapiens. I mentioned the fact that he was so interested in the Confucian texts, in the ancient classical texts, and he saw that as a way to return and better understand this sage kingness. He was arguing in a way to return from the neo-Confucian sources, and that is still for me all very, very difficult to understand, but still return to the principles of government that he understood were the principles of those ancient sage kings. Which then he thought were the source of the success of the Chinese Empire in being at that time an empire of peace rather than war, and what was so in his understanding so attractive about the rule of the emperor, since he secured peace and stability while Europe was, as I was saying, so unstable and uncertain and full of force. To come to the end, we really have to wrap up, as I see now, a couple of elements that I summed up at the end of my talk, but came already, were mentioned earlier. So his interest in the ancient texts was really related to the idea that there he would find these principles that explain so much of the benevolence and the ethics that was so fruitful in the Chinese situation. The way that he thought that the different bodies of thought could relate was through this notion of natural reason and natural law, and as I was saying, this principle of Li. Now, it really is related also to the notion of God, but God is not in Leibniz's thought, is not some sort of person with a beard, and it's not so personified as one would maybe think of, or someone would think of on the current basis. It is really, I understand that he could relate to the principle of Li as a universal cause and a universal, because that is also for Leibniz what God was at the time. But it has, of course, this personification as well. But he was such a mathematical mind that it also had this meaning, God as the universal cause. Now, what strikes me is the way he wants to celebrate diversity at the time that was not necessarily part of the discourse. I mean, colleagues, rationalist colleagues, would not even be so interested, I would say, in other cultures because they thought, well, we can reason ourselves out of problems and we don't really need to study other cultures to see and deal with global problems. So I think it is extremely interesting that Leibniz took this course, developed his universal jurisprudence related to a German-European situation, but really ultimately could apply it to the world as a whole, and that he valued the exchange with the other and in an attempt to for us all to individuals and communities to cultivate the self, to lead towards some sort of perfection. There is this moral dimension in his socio-political thinking, and to overcome the more evil parts of human nature, and that he was really open to learning and discussing and that in that sense, his theory and the universal theory held, how do you call it, kept stood. Let me put it like that. So, to conclude, a couple of things. I will go through it in a bit of a different order than put down here. As I said, Leibniz celebrates diversity, is happy with the different manifestations, particular manifestations of the universal, you could say. He thinks that to learn we should include the other. And that is a confirmation of the universal and the way that humanity can search for enlightenment. He was the last defender of you could say, not only the Holy Roman Empire and its universal structures. He redefined that, but he was also maybe, in a way, one of the last defenders of the law of nations and nature. We know that Vattel studied Leibniz, and Vattel is obviously going into a very voluntarist direction. And you could say that it is exactly that natural law order that Leibniz wants to keep on board that makes him find this innovative notion of international legal personality, which mirrors his idea of a universal natural order that accommodates all these differences. And so it is what he calls, and that's my last bullet point, an empire of reason. And I haven't find out I have to go back to the German sources, what exactly is used there. But it's obvious, as I was just saying, that he works with some, not with a rule of law in the sense of what maybe today is called rule of law, but he with the idea there is a normative order which has to bind and is binding upon all sovereigns and rulers, upon all who have some sort of power, and they're bound by the rule of reason, of natural reason. And their responsibility goes further than just not to violate a positive law of nations or a positive law. It is built on a notion of justice that includes the caring for others. Let me stop there.
Well, I failed in the protocol of appointing a chairperson, but we have at least 20 minutes to take questions or have discussion before the schedule for lunch, and we can go on longer if we wish. Would anybody like to make any comment on either paper? Albert, yes?
Just a clarification about the Chinese language used when Leibniz commented on the classical Chinese text. This reference to the Li, Professor Niemann talked about the Li, L-I. But I was wondering which Chinese character that refers to, because one version of the Li means rituals or rites, R-I-T-E-S. And the other character, Chinese character for the Li is as in reason. So which Li was Leibniz talking about?
Something that I will show to you during the break on the pages. I mean, I cannot, unfortunately, tell you. But it is something that scholarship is aware of. And also, Leibniz seems to be aware of it. So I will show you the actual character. But the understanding is that it is about this reason element in his work. Could you use your microphone? It's like
basically, Leibniz was using the Li as a principle, and you translate it as a principle, because sometimes we translate Li as principle, or sometimes pattern, or sometimes coherence, but it's kind of very much metaphysical term, which was used by Neo-Confucian. So when we talk about Li and Qi is kind of vital force, kind of Then Leibniz adapted this term, the Li, in this Neo-Confucian metaphysical context, and then turned it into kind of natural reason in a way that Westerners were. So the question is whether East Asian New Confucians understood the Li as kind of reason as Westerners understood, or differently. But obviously, Chinese understood Li quite differently because they have very different metaphysics as a background and different cosmology. And so it was more like, I don't want to go into it, but the bottom line is Leibniz picked up this idea, not ritual Li, but Li. Sometimes Chinese now use like Li Xing, the reason, rationality, you know, to translate region into Chinese term, but then that kind of Li was the kind of Li that Leibniz was using. So,
if that's the case, then maybe Leibniz is more influenced by Neo-Confucianism than the classical Confucianism.
Yeah, definitely was influenced by Neo-Confucianism. He was using. He was influenced by compendium, but basically he was using by, you know, the four books, the Confucian that was reinvented by Zhu Xi, actually. So it was much more influenced by Neo-Confucian than classical Chinese.
Yeah, that's where he seems to relate to, and also through this Jesuit world that facilitates his learning about Neo-Confucianism and what he hopes to learn about Confucianism. And of course, that is his interpretation, and it's the interpretation of the Jesuits being here and working with those translations as well. And of course, it resonates his own thinking, but I would say, in comparison to a lot of his contemporaries, he is really eager to understand it also as something different, even though that is, of course, difficult. But he does acknowledge that it's something different, but he searches ways to relate to it and to understand it. And that goes through concepts and the problems as translation, as we'll see later today. I think that those problems of translation are part of the 17th century, early 18th century of Leibniz's relation with this body of Chinese, with these Chinese ideas. But contrary to his European peers, I think there is an eagerness to understand exactly the differences also, because it ultimately are different manifestations of something deeply united. And
yes, Christoph?
First of all, thank you very much for your papers, which I enjoyed thoroughly. May I perhaps ask two questions, one to you, Tony, in relation to Richelieu. If I see it correctly, the French kings had been the first amongst the Christian rulers to enter into contractual relations with non-Christian powers, as can be seen in the treaties between Francis the First and Solomon the Magnificent. Is there any particular mentioning or treatment of such treaties, such relations with non-Christian nations by Richelieu? And the second question would be to you, Jana, as regards Leibniz. You explained very much how he engaged with Chinese moral philosophy. Does he also, for example, deal with Chinese foreign policy at that time? So the relationship between Chinese rulers and external powers?
I don't fully understand your question. I mean, I think Francis I made a treaty with the Ottomans, yeah. But what is your question?
If Richelieu dealt with that question, if it is, I mean, in canon law, such treaties were treated as imperium foedus, so as non-permissible treaties in traditional canon law. Does Richelieu treat or deal with that question of if such treaties can be...
Yes, I have come across... this issue has come up because Père Joseph, his sidekick, wanted France to wage a new crusade against the Ottomans and against the Muslims. And so Richelieu was not interested, and nor was Louis. And I think their religious conviction is something about their own relationship with God and the implications of that for the way they behave. It's not at all a religious conviction which is homogenizing in terms of how they should behave with others. In fact, Richelieu was in constant conflict with important parts of the French court, including the mother of Louis, Catherine de' Medici, I think, the mother of Louis the 13th, because his whole foreign policy was built around alliances with Protestant princes and kings against Catholic princes and kings. So the religious faith is merely his utterly personal foundation for his confidence that he can understand what is happening. It has nothing to do with how he should relate to other people, and that there he was totally agnostic and followed whatever he thought was rational and reasonable. So his primary allies were the Dutch and the Swedes, who he funded the French state bankrolled the Dutch rebellion against Spain. And bankrolled the armies of Gustav of Sweden. So I think that is an aspect. There was a constant tension between, in the French court, between Richelieu's religious conviction and the absence of any interest that he had in solidarity with Catholic powers. And but the issue, I haven't anything specific on his attitude to the Ottomans or to the Muslims, except that he simply ignored the request of his Père Joseph, who was his closest companion, who wanted another crusade against the Ottomans and against the Muslims. It's very, very... I mean, part of the appeal for Richelieu to me is that he's so outrageous from the point of view of modernity.
Thanks so much, Christoph. It gives me also an opportunity to expand a bit on something. Yeah, I introduced his thinking about, let's say, inter-sovereign, inter-ruler relations through the European context, and then jumped to his interest in China. But it is indeed true that he included, for instance, the Treaty of Nerzinski. Am I saying it right? The treaty between Russia and China on the border. He includes that in the news from China, and that has been negotiated with the help of Jesuits, and he finds that a important way of solving conflicts. So he mentions it also as a way of illustrating that international conflicts need to be solved through arbitration rather than through warfare. So it is very much part of this wise rule that he understands the emperor to uphold. Thanks. Yeah.
Scott, yes.
Thank you. I have a question for each of you. Thank you very much for your papers. To Tony, I wonder, there might be a sort of curious symmetry between the two positions, the Machiavelli-Richelieu position and then the Vattel position that you ended up with. You said that for the Machiavelli position, morality can only exist on an island created or protected by immorality. That was a quote that you used. Yeah. But there's something in the Vattelian position that seems to be the same, that it points to the diabolical, as you said at the end, which is beyond the organized internal organization of a state. There is this immorality, there's this realm of you know, incoherence, of non-gathered normativity of some kind, you know, of power, essentially. Mm. Yeah. So in that sense, there seems to be a structural similarity between the Machiavellian story and the Vattel story there as well. If I could ask another question, I wonder, you've shown that Leibniz has an interest in Chinese philosophy and politics, but I wonder whether there's any more that you need to show to demonstrate something more thorough, you know, something like he's attempting some kind of synthesis here. I think you've shown a coincidence through the interest, but whether there's something grander going on remains to be seen. And I was struck by the line that you quoted from him that about the mission for the glory of God and the propagation of the Christian religion doesn't sound very multicultural. So in that sense, I wonder whether there is anything more than just a coincidence, whether there is really a co-mingling, an attempt to synthesize in some way two very different traditions.
Thanks for the question, Scott. I think that I would agree with you, but I would say that most international lawyers would not. I think that the realist view of international relations, also taken up by postmodernist views of international relations, is that it's based on the notion of the domestic order versus international disorder. But international lawyers, I think, in a rather woolly and vague way, see that Vattel represents the view that the world community consists of sovereign, independent, equal states that normally have peaceful and relatively unproblematic relations with one another, and can conclude treaties which they observe and will refrain from attacking one another because they are all ostensibly status quo powers. And so Vattel is then presented as an 18th century enlightened, uncomplexed, comfortable individual, and international lawyers are very happy with that. But there were a number of symposia about Vattel in Switzerland, celebrating him in the spring of 2008, which marked the 150th anniversary of the publication of his work. I think that underlying Vattel is basically a metaphysics of realism going back to Hobbes, because his central concept is the one of security. And the security of the state and the self-preservation of the state. And he has parallels that doctrine with the doctrine of the absolute sovereignty of the individual state, which is totally free as a matter of conscience. It reads like elementary type of Protestant Reformation theology, that each individual state is entitled to follow its conscience in interpreting what it considers necessary for the for its security. And in my view, that is effectively, possibly, ultimately a Machiavellian view, that the world around the state is fundamentally unstable. But the international lawyers will not agree with one another about this, and the majority view is that it's a rather happy, it basically comes back to the boring question, does international law exist or not? And is it does it work or not? And the majority of international lawyers think it does, and the majority of international relations scholars think it doesn't, and that's why they choose these different disciplines. I agree. I think that partially the attraction of Richelieu, and he's a recent discovery for me, is that he does seem to have a more realist, penetrating view of international society, but he still is able to come back and to be, I think, the real founder of modern international law, because he is the genius behind the treaties of Münster and Westphalia. But he has this kind of metaphysical religious conviction, which enables him not to be, well, to put it in very crude terms, in a permanent state of panic, which is what we are in the West at the moment, in a permanent state of panic over ISIS or whatever. I mean, ISIS is the latest source of panic. But no, I got myself into a dark corner in these Swiss celebrations by saying that fundamentally to me, Vattel is a suave and rather cynical Machiavellian who's simply inviting states to do as they please and call it law.
Thanks so much. Is it really a multicultural appreciation of the world? I think very valid and right. Rightful question. It's actually why I was wondering whether I should use that quote, because it needs a lot of other quotes to put it in the right perspective. And you see, I think one of the other quotes really talks about superiority of the Chinese in ethics and political. So there is no reservation to say really and admit that there is superiority there, and you see this attempt, and of course with all its shortcomings, this attempt to penetrate this different world of ideas with all the limitations of the knowledge at the time, and it is exactly, I would say, Leibniz's understanding of Christian religion, which was very ecumenical, that helps us out here. It helps us understand that to Leibniz, all these different denominations are, again, expressions of something deeper that is the core, which also, again, goes to something universal and deep that is expressed in different cultural and metaphysical ways, but ultimately goes back to what he understands as what is just and the approximation of God is really about perfection of humanity, and that is where he thinks he can relate to the self-cultivation in the Chinese tradition and He is not a modernist in the sense of the Enlightenment that follows. He really tries to keep one foot in the moral philosophy and the metaphysics that are part of late medieval times. You could debate it. My sense is of all the based on all the different texts and also other texts on where he really studies what he calls the natural theology of Confucianism, and that there is an attempt to really appreciate it for a multicultural, really appreciate the different cultures as a way on our and the commerce of light, the exchange of all the ideas as a way to common human enlightenment. And yet you could say that coming from Europe with his frame of mind, putting that on in a way to get a grip and get an understanding on that different tradition, of course, things go wrong. But
I would like to add as a comment to Jan's answer, having just read her paper yesterday, monadology, the notion of universality in diversity. Mm-hmm. Now, the official Chinese policy at the moment is to adapt the form of Confucianism, which says that this universality, the very nature of universality is to express diversity and difference. And it is opposed then to a homogenous notion of universality, which quite simply means, you know, liberal, Western market, democracy, individual values, and so on. And I think it's possible to maybe explore more fully Leibniz's theory of monadology, which is certainly a crucial and central part of his theory, alongside maybe less government-dominated or more ideological-dominated versions of what Confucianism means by the diversity, universality through diversity. I think there is a possible fundamental philosophical affinity worth exploring in mind. I would just add that. Yeah. It's very striking. Mm. Any more challenges or questions? People want their lunch. Well, then, we have a lunch, I think quite a luxurious lunch from the look of it, on the third floor, a buffet. We make our way down to the third floor of this building, and I would imagine that it's supposed to be for speakers or participants, but I imagine there's plenty for everybody, and everybody would be welcome to join in our festivities, which would go on for at least an hour and a quarter. We would reassemble then.